Thank you very much indeed. And first of all, can I check that my voice is clear enough? Is this loud enough?
It's clear. Thank you.
So first of all, I'd like to thank the permanent mission of Sri Lanka to the UN in Geneva for arranging this event. This is the second year I've been able to participate, and I'm very happy to be able to offer a few reflections on this occasion. So I will begin in our traditional way of paying my respects to the Lord Buddha and say starting the Dhamma talk by inviting everyone to compose the mind and to listen attentively. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Buddhang dhammang sanghang namassami. On this occasion of Visakha Puja, this year 2021, I am very happy to offer these reflections. The title of the talk today that was suggested to me was Timeless Teaching of the Buddha in Our Own Time. So I thought I would reflect on these three significant events in the life of the Lord Buddha that so many of the representatives have mentioned, and to consider how these are significant, or how we can reflect upon these to inform our life and our work in the world during these difficult times of the COVID pandemic, but also many other difficulties and struggles that are occurring around the planet. So first of all, the birth of the Bodhisattva took place in Lumbini, as was mentioned by the representative from Nepal. And one of the interesting teachings that the Buddha gave with respect to his birth is in a sutta in the Majjhima Nikaya called Wonderful and Marvelous. It's sutta number 123. So I thought I would share that with you today, as it bears very directly upon our, how we can work with our minds to make our life and the lives of people around us more beneficial and of more effective in the work that we do. The story begins with Venerable Ananda gathered together with a few other Sangha members in a hall in the monastery, and the Venerable Ananda was describing to the group the many wonderful and marvelous miraculous events around the birth of the Bodhisattva, saying how the Queen Mahamaya, she didn't experience any discomfort during the time that she was pregnant, how she'd had a dream of a white elephant with six tusks entering her side. It was indicated the conception of the Bodhisattva in her womb, how when she gave birth standing up and didn't experience any pain, and that when the baby appeared, then the baby was caught by devatas, and that the air from the sky that produced streams of cool and warm water to wash the newborn baby. And after each of these statements, Venerable Ananda said, "This is another wonderful and marvelous quality of the Lord Buddha." Then he described how immediately after the birth of the Bodhisattva, he stood up and walked and took seven steps, and a lotus flower appeared from the ground under each footstep. And again, saying, "This is a wonderful and marvelous quality of the Lord Buddha." And then after taking seven steps, then the newborn baby raised a hand in the air and said, "I am the leader in the world. I am the foremost in the world. And this is another wonderful and marvelous quality of the Lord Buddha." So this list of miraculous and extraordinary events was being described by Venerable Ananda. And then at that point, the Lord Buddha himself arrived in the hall. And as he usually did on these occasions, he said, "What was the reason that you were gathered here? What were you talking about? And what was the discussion that was interrupted when I arrived? Because you all stopped speaking when I appeared in this Dhamma hall." So Venerable Ananda described exactly what he had been saying to the rest of the Sangha, and said, "You know, these are wonderful and marvelous qualities of the Lord Buddha." So then after hearing that whole recitation, then the Buddha said, would you like to hear of another wonderful and marvelous quality of the Tathagata? And you can imagine them all sort of leaning forward and thinking, oh yes, we'd like to hear some more. This is these amazing, incredible stories. This is so strange, so mysterious, so wonderful, so inspiring. But what the Lord Buddha said to the group was, when a feeling arises in the mind of the Tathagata, he knows that this is a feeling. He knows it's arising. He knows its persistence. He knows it's passing away. This too is a wonderful and marvelous quality of the Tathagata. When a perception arises in the mind of the Tathagata, he knows this is a perception. He knows it in its arising, in its abiding, in its passing away. This too is a wonderful and marvelous quality of the Tathagata. And then lastly, when a thought arises in the mind of the Tathagata, he knows this is a thought. He knows it in its arising, in its passing. This too is a wonderful and marvelous quality of the Tathagata. And so remember this, Ananda, these are wonderful and marvelous qualities of the Tathagata. So as the Buddha often did in his way of teaching, particularly when the Venerable Ananda was getting over-enthusiastic, the Lord Buddha would steer the focus of attention in a slightly different way. And so rather than focusing on these miraculous and strange events like the being caught by devas when he was born, or the being washed by cool and warm streams of water, or walking immediately after birth, these are incredible, extraordinary things. The Buddha said, what's really interesting, what's really valuable, is that we can watch our minds. That is a really wonderful and marvelous thing. So many of the representatives mentioned the qualities of Buddhist meditation and the universal applicability of mindfulness, and how popular and valuable that's being seen to be around the world at the moment. And I feel this very principle, this kind of this miraculous capacity that we have to watch our minds, is something that is of great significance and importance in the world. That irrespective of whether you happen to come from a Buddhist background or Christian background or Muslim or Sikh or Hindu or Jewish or whatever one's say spiritual orientation, the ability to watch the mind is exactly the same. We're all human beings. We're built the same way, irrespective of our religious conditioning. And so this the spread of mindfulness around the world in this current time, I would also like to credit with Dr. Jon Kabat-Zinn in America, who founded his training of mindfulness-based stress reduction, and then the development of that into what's called mindfulness-based cognitive therapy by Dr. Mark Williams, Dr. Zindel Siegel, and Dr. John Teasdale. These gentlemen developed this program very much based around Buddhist insight. John Teasdale made the comment that it was listening to a Dhamma talk by Ajahn Sumedho, my own teacher, where Ajahn Sumedho made the point that our thoughts are not true and our thoughts are not our own. They don't belong to us. And Dr. John Teasdale, he took that principle, worked it together with mindfulness-based stress reduction, and developed mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, particularly focused on being a resource for working with depression. But it's also applicable in many other areas. And the essence of that mode of working with the mind, which I really rejoice in the fact that it's usable by people of every background, every spiritual disposition, and from school children, people in the business world, people in the medical field, this capacity that we have to watch our mind and to be able to know this is a thought, this is a feeling, this is an emotion, to watch it arise, to know it as it's present, and to watch it pass away. This, I feel, is an extraordinarily precious gift that the Buddha's teaching has brought to us. And the many and various, say, descriptions of meditation that we have in the Buddhist suttas, they go into a great detail. But I feel that in this current time, particularly dealing with feelings of anxiety, fear with respect to the COVID-19 pandemic, dealing with social issues that here in the UK, the levels of domestic violence have increased enormously during the pandemic. The difficulties, economic difficulties, stresses of businesses closing down have been very high. So many say problems have arisen during the pandemic, along with the medical ones. And I feel that this say, trainings in mindfulness and the use of mindfulness practices to within the educational field, within the business world, within the medical field, mental health and also physical health. These are a wonderful legacy that we have received from the Buddha and described there in that sutta of the wonderful and marvelous to say when we are able to watch our mind, then rather than reacting to like and dislike, reacting to fear and aversion or desire in a compulsive way, we can be responsive rather than reactive. That quality of mindfulness enables us to deal with what we like without chasing after it, what we dislike without fighting against it and fearing it and hating it. So this, I would say, is in terms of reflecting on the birth of the Lord Buddha, this is a teaching that we can very much bring into our world of today and brings many, many blessings with it. It's also of note that before the development of mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, the ability for the in psychiatry and psychotherapy to deal with recurrent depression only had a success rate of 5 to 10% maximum. With this method of approach, they found a success rate of 50%. I'm not making significant outrageous claims, but these are figures that were given to me by people actually working in the field. So it's a remarkably effective tool, and I'm really delighted to see how helpful that is around the world. With respect to reflecting on the Buddha's enlightenment, many of the people who spoke today, your excellencies, referred to the quality of non-violence. And I feel that the description of the Buddha's enlightenment under the Bodhi tree is extremely relevant in that respect, because sometimes the Buddha's enlightenment is talked about as the battle with Mara, that Mara came along to try and dissuade the Buddha or the Bodhisattva from his path towards enlightenment. But I would also suggest it wasn't a battle. Mara was trying to attack, but the Buddha did not fight back. That this is a radical and fundamental non-contentious approach, that the Buddha did not fight with Mara, and Mara attempted to threaten or tempt or challenge the Buddha with the various forces, but it was not through, the Buddha trying to wipe out evil, quote-unquote, that the Mara was defeated or Mara failed, but rather it was through the Buddha's application of an attitude of wisdom, of awareness, and non-contention. So under the Bodhi tree, the forces of Mara were firstly those of fear, sent in the army of demons to try and bring up the aversion or fear in the Bodhisattva. And he knew that this is just Mara's army. There's nothing to be afraid of. And as they hurled spears and arrows were fired towards him, the spears turned into beams of light, and the arrows turned into flowers and rained down on the ground. And the Buddha was unable to be hurt. Then the daughters of Mara were sent in to try and move the Bodhisattva's mind towards desire. But again, he wasn't shaken. He wasn't disturbed or moved by that. And then lastly, according to some versions of the story, the vision of the Buddha's father, King Suddhodana, appeared before him with tears running down his face, saying, "You know, the kingdom is falling apart since you left. You're such a gifted boy. You know, you're so wonderful as a prince, and you've gone off to live this religious life, and you know things are falling apart. But you know, I understand that you want to do your spiritual thing. But really, just to let you know that the kingdom would be so much better if you came back and took over." And so this is the forces of responsibility and duty. And again, the Buddha was unshaken by that, was not taken in. And he knew that this was another, attempt by Mara to move him, to dissuade him from the path of enlightenment. So in reflecting upon this, I feel that particularly when we're faced with difficulties, with the COVID-19 pandemic or social difficulties, people very easily blame the government, get angry with the people running the countries or running the health programs. And people very easily We make enemies and we blame the enemy, and then we think if we just got rid of the enemy, we wipe them out, we destroy that, then our problems will be over. But as Alexander Solzhenitsyn once observed in one of his books, he said, it would be so easy if we could take everything that's evil, put it in one place and wipe it out, and then all that would be left would be good. The fact is that the line between good and evil runs right down the middle of the heart of every human being. And so what I feel we have in the Buddha's enlightenment and the mythical symbolism of Mara's attack on the Buddha under the Bodhi tree is the Buddha meets Mara with understanding, and a fundamental attitude of non-contention. He refused to make Mara the enemy. He refused to make those forces of confusion and desire and fear and responsibility. He refused to make them an enemy. And through understanding and through that quality of awareness, then his heart was fully liberated. Those forces of fear and aversion and desire and duty were not able to confuse or disturb his heart. So I feel in these times, this represents this fundamental quality of non-contention. Even when we might have a good reason to complain or get upset or blame the other, that when the mind moves towards aversion and hatred, that is antithetical to the Buddha's way. As he said in the Dhammapada, hatred is never conquered by hatred. Hatred is only ever conquered by love. This is the law, ancient and inexhaustible. So that I feel is such an important principle for us when it's so easy to get upset, to blame and to contend. And maybe the Buddha under the Bodhi tree being, say, oppressed by the armies and the forces of Mara, it's a very colorful and remote image. But right there in the offices of your homes at the UN in Geneva, or in our different businesses, our monasteries, that these same forces of fear and aversion, of desire, of duty, they can still rise up, and those oppressive presences can be here in our lives. But if we genuinely take refuge in the Buddha, then at that moment, there is the quality of wisdom that in the Buddha which says, I know you, Mara, I know what this is. And that then there is a refusal to make that into an enemy. So that which we fear, we know there is, this is the feeling of fear, that which is attractive. We know this is the feeling of attraction, that which is, say, the pull of responsibility, you know, you should, that you should, wagging finger of duty. We can understand that, and in exactly the same way as I was describing with respect to the birth of the Bodhisattva, there's that quality of awareness, of mindful attunement to the situation, so the heart can respond with wisdom and adapt to the situation according to the need, from a responsivity and attunement to the time, the place, the situation, and whether it's time to take action and do something, or time to be still, time to speak up or to be quiet, those actions are guided solely by mindfulness and wisdom in a responsive way, rather than a half-conscious reaction to like and dislike and to compulsion or to social pressure. But I feel that's a very helpful principle for us in our many meetings, our discussions, and our working with our lives in the world. Another aspect of the Buddha's enlightenment and the story of the Buddha under the Bodhi tree is even when the Buddha had reached a full enlightenment and Mara was unable to disturb or upset the Buddha, Mara refused to retreat. He wouldn't back off. And he said, you claim to be fully enlightened, you gave up on your family, you walked away from the palace in Kapilavatu, you gave up on your wife and child, then you became a yogi, you gave up on the life of a yogi, you were a failed ascetic, and now you're sitting under this tree alone in the woods, and you're claiming to be fully enlightened. This is a joke. I mean, you're claiming to be the great spiritual figure, the central, most powerful spiritual figure in the universe, It's ridiculous. You know, I am the one who should claim supremacy over the universe. You know, I am truly the leader in the universe, am I not? And he says, calls upon his army to be his witness. And the 700,000 strong army say, yes, indeed, your majesty, you are indeed the Lord of the universe. So Mara said, so, you know, these are my witnesses that support my claim to supremacy in the universe. Who do you have to back you up? And that's when the Buddha reached down and touched the earth. And then the earth goddess Dharani rose up from the earth. And then she said this great declaration, this is my true son. And he has done everything necessary to claim full and complete enlightenment. And you, Mara, are defeated. Then she unwrapped her hair. And this great flood of water appeared from her hair. And the army of Mara was washed away. So again, that might sound like a very remote and strange, say, mythical tale, but it relates to our own life in very practical ways. That the Buddha reached down and touched the earth. He called upon the earth mother to be his witness. So in a way, when his experience of enlightenment was just internal, he knew that his heart was liberated, but it was an internal experience, that reaching down and touching the earth, calling upon the material world and the forces of nature to be his witness, that touching the earth is how wisdom interacts with compassion, I would say. How in our reflections on the nature of the Buddha, how vijja, awareness and awakened wisdom, combines together with charana, skillful conduct. We speak of the qualities of the Buddha, vijja, charana, sampanno, impeccable, fully accomplished, in knowledge and conduct, in wisdom and conduct. So along with the vijja as the internal experience, it was only when he touched the earth and the earth goddess became his witness, then the forces of Mara were truly dispelled. So I feel that that's a powerful spiritual symbol for us. So it's not just a matter of us having insight or a quality of understanding. That understanding needs to be embodied in what we do, in what we say, and the work we engage in compassionate activity in the world. And particularly many of you were speaking about the importance of cooperation, of establishing values of equality and fairness, like sharing the vaccines equally around the world. I fully support that initiative from our representative from the Republic of Laos. And these, the principles of fairness, justice, cooperation, or as was said right at the beginning, you know, a coordinated multilateral response. I would say that's the touching of the earth. Okay, there might be these qualities of wisdom and awareness, but how do we bring that into the world? What's the charana? What's the conduct that matches that that is the natural, say, emergent quality from that wisdom? And so wisdom on its own, avijja on its own, in a way, that in that symbol of the Buddha's enlightenment, Mara's army is not dispelled, but it's when that the quality and the humility to touch the earth, that the Buddha was humble enough to say, yes, I need a witness. And when he was humble enough to acknowledge that a witness was needed, then the earth goddess Dharani rose up, and then the enlightenment was complete in that way. So this is not the only way to interpret these stories. I wouldn't say this needs to be looked upon as definitive. I'm not making that claim. But one way of reflecting upon these stories and how they can inform the way that we work in the world. Similarly, in terms of conduct, charana, in our Buddhist tradition, we speak of the five precepts as a basic mode of behavior and conduct, skillful behavior in the world. And yes, I would say that crosses religious barriers, and whether we have a commitment to a particular religious path or not, that living by the five precepts is something that the Lord Buddha outlined as something that's intrinsically skillful and beneficial, however we call it, whatever way we language it, choosing non-violence, to not kill, choosing to respect the property of other people, to not steal, to have responsible relationships in terms of our connection with other people, to be not deceitful or abusive or taking advantage of people in terms of sexual behavior and relationships, to not steal, to too, is a way of one aspect of honesty, but not cheating on your partner is another, a very important aspect of honesty. To not lie, to observe the precept of honesty in our speech, in our actions, the way we represent ourselves in the world is very important. And then the fifth precept of refraining from drugs and alcohol that confuse the mind, that dull mindfulness. That's according to our Buddhist texts, the fifth precept is in a slightly different category to the first four. Sometimes the Buddha mentions just the first four in terms of wholesome action, kusala kamma. But the fifth precept is in a way almost more important than the first four, because when, as I'm sure everybody who's assembled here today knows, when you've had a few drinks, so you've had taken some drugs that dull the mindfulness, then the first four precepts have are much less likely to sustain themselves. It brings the fence down that guards the heart from engaging in foolish and destructive behaviors. So living by the five precepts, the Buddha referred to not just as a limit on our behavior, but he also called these the five mahadana, the five great gifts, in a sutta called the Streams of Merit in the Book of the Eights in the Anguttara Nikaya. Then the Buddha said, these are five great gifts. So when we choose to be nonviolent, we choose to respect the property of others, we choose to respect our relationships, we choose to not tell lies, and we choose to take the path of sobriety and mindfulness, that's a gift to the people that we live with. That's a gift to the world around us. So this is what is called abhayadana, the giving of fearlessness. And the Buddha, we often think of the precepts as don't do this, don't do that, and don't do this, don't do that as a set of limitations, but rather they can be seen as a gift, a way that you can actively benefit the world by people, when you're with them, they know they don't have to worry that you're going to lie to them, you're going to cheat, or you're going to cheat them. You don't have to protect your property or worry that you're going to be deceived or hurt, because that there's a gift of fearlessness. There's the abhayadana. The last thing I'd like to share, and I realize I've just got a few more minutes left, to reflect upon the parinibbana, the final passing away of the Lord Buddha. So one of the things that is significant, I feel, about the story, the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, Digha Nikaya, in the Long Discourses, Sutta number 16, is the discourse about the Buddha's final passing away, Mahaparinibbana Sutta. One of the things that he says in that sutta, again, when Mara comes along and tries to persuade the Buddha to pass away, and is engaging with the Buddha at that time, you know, the Buddha said, you know, many years ago, Mara, I told you that I wouldn't pass away until such a time as the fourfold assembly, the community of monks and nuns, lay women, lay men, had been established, and the Dhamma had been firmly grounded in the world. And I said, I wouldn't pass away until that had happened. But now, 45 years later, now that has been established, the fourfold assembly is established in the world, the Dhamma is well taught, well practiced, well remembered. And so now, Mara, it's time for me to pass away. And said, and in 3 months' time, in Kusinara, I will have my final passing away. So when we look at the Parinibbana and reflect upon that, I feel it's good to consider, well, what are our life goals? What are we trying to do with our life? What is the legacy that we want to leave? So the Lord Buddha had that intention. He said, okay, I'm not going to pass away until there's an assembly of monastics and lay people that can practice the teachings, until the Dhamma is well learned, well understood. And in that endeavor, you know, he's been remarkably successful. 2,600 years later, the Sangha is still active in the world. The Buddha Dhamma is a useful presence. So I feel it's important for us to consider, what are our life goals? And I realize I'm speaking to members of the Assembly of the United Nations, so this is a very altruistic and compassionate group of people that your life, your work, your lives, your work is very much built around helping others. So that those are worthy and noble goals, and I fully applaud and support that. But it's interesting to consider, so the Buddha had that intention, but he wasn't able to establish the teachings and the fourfold assembly just because it was an inspiration. It wasn't just an idea. It wasn't just a plan or a program that he worked out by himself or with his companions and friends. It was based upon his Samma Sambodhi, his full and complete enlightenment. That's how he was able to fulfill those goals. And so I feel that many of us with our life goals, we get distracted by, we have an altruistic intention, but we get caught up with putting up this building or setting up this organization or raising this amount of money or getting this book published. And I am speaking from personal experience. You know, I'm not pretending that I don't get distracted from more sort of lofty spiritual goals. But I feel that it's important in terms of our life goals that along with those the compassionate activity and effective programs that we can bring into the world, like, yeah, I'm abbot of a monastery and I work very hard to try and, say, create a good living conditions for the community, to be, say, putting things in place in the physical world. But I also recognize this is only going to work if the primary concern is my own mind. If I get too busy with the programs and all the meetings and all of the lists of things to do, and I neglect my own mind, my own state of spiritual well-being, then you know you might have a lot of meetings and things might get discussed, but ultimately things I would suggest they won't bear so much fruit as if they are informed by the most sort of wholesome and wise of attitudes. So what I like to suggest in terms of life goals, along with the programs that we have or the institutions that we want to bring into being or the books we want to publish and so on, that we put as a central effort of our lives, realization. So the resolution to realize stream entry, sotapanna or sakadagami, once returning or non-returning or arahatship. At the very least, I would say, aim at, realize the insights pertaining to stream entry. I feel that in a way it's almost like something that is people might think of as being inflated or overambitious or that's something for other people. But I feel that you know the Buddha was so effective in his work in the world because of his extraordinarily liberated mind and the depth of wisdom that came from his liberation. So that if we really want our work in the world to be most effective, I would suggest the more that is informed by a genuine quality of liberation of the heart, that will be, say, the greatest legacy or the most, say, beneficial bequest that can come from our lives into the world. So with this respect, it might seem like a bit of a tall order, but I would suggest that rather than making our worldly goals just either on a superior level, establishing wholesome, compassionate programs, but on a less exalted level, for many people, the goal of their life is a good retirement home, being able to get your kids into your grandchildren into good colleges, to have your company make a lot of money or be expanded around the world. Or to have you know your publications, your academic papers, or your books being admired and getting rave reviews in prestigious journals and newspapers, you know, or leaving a lot of money to your children and your grandchildren, or you know, getting a big fancy obituary in the early you know the towards the front of the national newspaper. I would say we can do better than that. We can, those things I would say are an offshoot or a side effect of our lives. But the more that we can direct our efforts towards the realization of stream entry or deeper levels of liberation, then that is a very skillful and helpful life goal to set in place to make that kind of resolution. And then in that respect, I feel that it's the last thing I thought I would share today is what the Buddha described in what's called the Siddhaka Sutta or the simile of the acrobats. This is in the Sanyutta Nikaya, the connected discourses in about Satipatthana, the foundations of mindfulness. The Buddha tells a story of how in the town of Siddhaka there was a street acrobat and his a little assistant called who's had the nickname Frying Pan. And there's no it's not described why her name was Frying Pan, but seems to be what her name was. And it was a street acrobat, and so the father said to the child, and it would be the kind of acrobatic trick where the father would hold up a bamboo pole and the child would climb up the pole and do various tricks. Those of you who are familiar with the, well, who live in India, you might have seen the street acrobats still doing these things. But on the cover of the book, A Fine Balance by an author called Rohit Mistry, there's a photograph of such an acrobat and a little child at the top of the pole. So the father said, I'll be mindful of you. You be mindful of me. That's the way that you can climb up the pole, do your tricks, climb down safely, and we'll please the crowd and get a good fee. And then the little girl said, "No, that's not the right way around. I'll look after what I do. You look after what you do. I'll be mindful of me. You be mindful of you. That's the way. I'll climb up to the safely up the pole, do my tricks. We'll please the crowd, get a good fee, and I'll come down safely from the pole." And then the Buddha said, in this instance, the child was correct and the elder was incorrect. And by helping ourselves, that's the best way that we have of helping others is to help ourselves. And how do we help others by helping ourselves? By practicing the four foundations of mindfulness: mindfulness of the body, mindfulness of feelings, mindfulness of moods and mind states, and mindfulness in terms of Dhamma. Practicing the four foundations of mindfulness, that's how, by helping ourselves, we most effectively help others. But then he also goes on to say, but also by helping others we also help ourselves, but that's come second. And how is it by helping others that we also help ourselves? Because by helping others we're practicing loving kindness, metta, patience, kantiya, harmlessness, avihinsaya, and sympathy, anudayataya. By practicing those qualities in relationship to helping others, that also rebounds and resonates and benefits our own lives. So I take this occasion to encourage all of us who are engaged in a lot of compassionate and important work in the world that to see that I offer for reflection that the way our work and our lives can be most effective in the world is if we place the development of wisdom, insight, and liberation of our own life, our own heart, our own mind at the very center, and that that's how we most effectively help others is through that the development of the foundations of mindfulness, the factors of enlightenment, and the liberation that comes from that. So I offer these words for consideration on this occasion today. And please, whatever is useful that I have said, please take it and keep it with you. Whatever is not useful, then please leave it aside.
Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.